Good morning, everybody. I don't know, that was kind of weak. You want to try it again? Good morning, everybody. Way better. Happy Sunday, everyone. It's good to be here with y'all, as always. Sundays are the best days of the week, and today we got a super special service for you. We've had a great week, had a great marriage fellowship, had a youth group today, have communion today, got awesome worship today. We got Pastor Alvin today in continuing his series in Nehemiah called Dare to Lead, so we're super excited about that. And we're just happy to be here with y'all. So tell you what, let's all stand up and we'll pray and we'll worship and we're going to start off a great Sunday, all right? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just come to you this morning, so grateful to be together, so grateful to be in your house, so grateful to be saved and on our way to heaven, Lord Jesus. And we just lift up our voices to you, we lift up our arms to you, we lift up our hearts to you. We want to serve you today. We want to worship you today. So we pray for your Holy Spirit to be in this place. We pray for you to speak a word right into our hearts, right where we need. Encourage us, challenge us, bless us, Father, by being in your word with your people. Thank you, and we pray this all in Jesus' name. All God's people said, amen. Let's worship.
Take care of that child. glorious day indeed. It's great to be here with you guys and just to continue to worship our Lord and Savior. But let's continue to prepare our hearts and really ask God to go before us so that we can be ready to receive what He has to give us this morning. So let's continue.
CF.com, and it was really nice to see a lot of you guys join us on Friday for our marriage fellowship. Good potluck, guys. Good food. Next one will be October 28th, so mark your calendar. Ladies, Connect Group will be this Thursday upstairs in Cafe 242, and you can ask Bree for more details, but I'll tell you now, it's at 6:30, and there'll be food, and study starts at 7, and they'll be on Zoom and in the Cafe 242. Great news, guys. Softball announcement. We got our first win. Woo! Big W, big W. Tomorrow's softball game starts at 6:30 at Joe Rogers Field. If you want to come and support us, just cheer us on. Maybe we can get another one. And today there is youth ministry, so it's the first of the month. They know there's donuts, and so join us right after announcements if you'd like. We have our ways to give to our youth or to our ministry. It's on the screen, and you can give in person, or you can give in the Agape box, or at these places. Okay. And I'd like to ask Pastor Darren to come up and pray for our tithing and offerings. Thanks.
Thank you, Miss Heidi. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you again just grateful for all that you do. You provide everything for us. You give us an abundance of material blessings, an abundance of friends and family around us, and people to love, and people who love us, and you give us everything all out of love. So Father, we offer it right back to you. We bring you our tithes and our offerings, and we worship you with our time, our talent, and our treasure. We want to serve you, Father. We want to serve your people. We want to see your kingdom grow. We want to see each of us grow. And so, Father, we just ask you to receive these offerings and multiply them for all of the ministries that you want to do, and use us for every part of that you want. And Father, we praise you in advance. We thank you in advance for all the good things you're doing. And we just ask you to let us be a part, whatever part you want, let us be a part of the kingdom work you're doing all around us. Thank you, Father. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Brought me out of darkness, you have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, I can't help but sing. My confidence.
just ministers to me, I can't help but thank God for his faithfulness to us in our lives. You know, I think of that verse in Matthew where God is talking about, you know, do not worry about, you know, what you will eat, the things that you will wear, for your Father knows that you need all these things. And I think, you know, so oftentimes we stress out in life on how are we going to pay the bills? How are we going to make it through this month? How are we going to, you know, make sure that our kids have what they need, right? Because it's not, you know, just making sure that we take care of ourselves, but we recognize sometimes we have to take care of other people. But, you know, when we trust that God is faithful, he gives us that peace that surpasses all understanding. Right? Because sometimes our understanding is what gets us in trouble. You know, we try to make sense of things, but when we realize that God is faithful, we don't know how he's going to get it to us, but we trust and we believe he's going to get it to us on time. Amen? And so God is good, you know, and if you are in a season where you are waiting, you're in a season where you feel like, Lord, I'm praying for this, know that God is not deaf. He hears you, and I promise you, he will answer you when it is time. Amen. But we can trust and believe in his faithfulness.
And resurrection.
to love you in return.
Would you pray with me this morning? Good morning, Father. We thank you, Lord, once again, Lord God, for your love and your grace and your goodness. Lord, thank you for allowing us, Lord, the privilege and the freedoms that we have in this country to gather as we do. Lord, I pray that it's something that we never take for granted, Lord God, especially having gone through what we've gone through, Lord, where the world was shut down and we weren't able to gather as we did, Lord, and how that affected us. And even to this day, we are still feeling the effects of that, Lord God, and how we live in a different world, in a different time, in a different space. But Lord, I thank you, Lord God, that slowly, Lord, your people are coming back, Lord God, and Lord, our hearts are being engaged, Lord God, and reignited for you, Lord. And so, Father, today, Lord, as we stand here together as the church of the living God, Lord, stones of your home, Lord, I pray, God, that you would be pleased to dwell in our midst, that you would inhabit the praises of your people, that you would bring refreshing and renewing through your presence and power, Father. Lord, that you would lift our heads, oh God. If there's anyone here that's discouraged or despondent, Lord God, I pray, Father, that you would just be the lifter of their heads, God, that you would extend your love and grace to them and meet them right where they are. And so, Father, we lift our voices again in praise and prayer and thanksgiving. And we invite you to come now, Lord God, and fill our hearts and fill this place. And I pray, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable unto you. And may your word go forth in power, bringing about the change that only you can bring through the power and the anointing of your Spirit. Lord, it's in Jesus' name we pray. Church says, amen. Good morning, family. Good morning to those of you who are online. I want you to turn around and say hello to your neighbor, and you may be seated. All right. It is always good to be amongst God's people, and I'm so blessed to be up here. Thank you guys for being here. I pray that you've had a great week. As Heidi was sharing, man, Friday was an incredible night of ministry. You know, I'm not just saying this because it was Daniel, but Daniel and Christine did such an amazing job. I was so blessed by their teaching and their. It was just such a great time of ministry, and so I was excited. But it's a joy to be amongst God's people today. And again, I want to welcome those of you who've tuned in. You couldn't be here, or maybe because you're far away. We're always blessed to know that you're tuning in. We're in a series right now that it's called Dare to Lead, as we're going through the book of Nehemiah, that focuses on the principles of leadership as we're looking at his life. Nehemiah was a man who was deeply burdened for his people because they were in a place where they were defenseless and just a lot of different things were happening that were not good. And so God had burdened his heart to go back and to minister to the people. And so as we're going through his journey of rebuilding the city and rebuilding the people who are greatly demoralized because they were in exile for 70 years, we learn some incredible lessons on leadership, incredible lessons on just how God has called us to make a difference. You know, the Bible tells us in Isaiah chapter 5, verses 20, it says, Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who substitute darkness for light and light for darkness. You know, as sad as it is for me to say, for me, we are living in these very days. We're living in these times where, as a country, it really does appear that we have lost our moral compass. And it's sad as you look at the laws that are being passed where, you know, and I'm not here to, I don't want to get political, you know, that's not my thing, and I don't want to do that. However, God has called us to pray for our leaders who are making decisions that affect our lives. Some of you may not know this, but the governor has passed a new law that, man, now you can kill a baby outside the womb up to 28 days after. I mean, it is absolutely despicable. It is sickening. I you know, and I'm not here to put him down. I'm here to plead with you to pray for him, to pray that God would bring him to repentance and that would open his eyes and see. I mean, how could anyone justify that? How could anyone justify killing a child outside of the womb? There's something wrong with that. There's something wrong with that. Do you know animals have more rights than the unborn child? Animals have more rights. And there's something definitely wrong. And so we need to pray for our leaders because, man, some of the laws that are being passed, they're frightening. Some of the things, you know, no longer are our teachers to be just educators, but now they're indoctrinating the children. When we, again, it's a frightening thing. And so we just need to pray. We need to pray because listen to what the scripture says. It says, woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who substitute darkness for light and light for darkness. Again, that's the times that we're living in where people are saying they're calling evil things good and good evil. Proverbs 29:2 says, when the godly are in authority, the people rejoice, but when the wicked are in power, they groan. And let me tell you right now, people are groaning. I mean, the economy is rough. I mean, gas prices, food prices, everything is skyrocketing. Even we as a church are feeling that. We're feeling that. You know what I mean? And so we really need to pray. And if there was ever a time that we needed leadership, and as we're talking about it, it's today. We need leadership in the country. We need leadership in our communities. We need leadership in our homes. We need leadership in our schools. We need leadership, period. I mean, it's serious business. You know what I mean? Because the quality of leadership affects the well-being of people. It affects our lives. And so, again, we really need to begin to pray. You know, I was speaking. I was actually, you know, had a great time. I was talking to Frank and Jessica this past Friday. And, you know, a lot of, you know, questions were being thrown at me. You know, Pastor Rafa, how come we don't talk about these things? And it's again, I don't like being political because I don't believe that the platform is for me to do that here. And so you'll never hear me advocate a political party. However, God does call us to be light and expose darkness. God does call us to speak in truth and to stand. And here's the thing. God always draws a line. He always draws a line and he says, whoever's on the Lord's side, stand here with me. You know what I mean? Moses did that. All of the leaders, Joshua said that as he took the mantle from Moses. You know, Joshua said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. But you choose this day whom you will serve. You choose this day the values that you will live your life, the values that you will adhere to that will govern your family. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And because we're in the house of God, you know, I tell you this, it's so important that you are sound in your thinking, that you're sound in the scriptures, because again, the lines have become so blurred that people can no longer distinguish right and wrong. There are certain things that are blatantly wrong, and yet we can't see them. And so again, we need leadership today. And if we can't give it to you in the church, something is wrong. If I can't speak truth in the church, something is wrong. We love everyone. I know that there are different walks of life. I know people have different trials and different struggles and different things happening in their life. But you know what? We're never going to candy coat things. Sin is sin, right is right, and wrong is wrong. And that's just the way it is. And so you know what? We're not here to step on anybody's toes. We're not here to be political. But this is the house of God. And this is where truth needs to be declared. And if we can't speak truth here, then we might as well close up shop. We have no business gathering together. I'm just wasting your time, right? We need leadership. And I'm looking among you, and I pray that God would really begin to burden your heart as he burdened Nehemiah's heart, as he was looking at the condition of his people, as he was looking at the condition of his community. His heart was so burdened that he recognized, I have to do something. And each one of us has been given a sphere of influence. Where that is and what that is, I don't know, but you've been given a sphere of influence to make a difference. You've been given a sphere of influence to be light and salt. You've been given a sphere of influence to be the aroma of Christ. And so we need to be all those things. We need to be all those things for such a time as this, as the book of Esther says. Man, we're living in days that I can't believe some of the things I hear on the news. I can't believe some of the things that are going on today, but they are. And so we need to be praying and seeking the Lord. Well, last week we looked at the first thing a leader does. How many of you remember what the first thing a leader does? Before he does anything else, what does a leader do? He prays. He seeks the heart and the mind of God. He prays. The next step a leader does is he plans. He plans. Praying and planning actually go hand in hand. It's in prayer God begins to reveal things and make things clear, which in turn gives you the foresight to begin to plan accordingly. This is why it's so important that we are in prayer, because it gives us the foresight to plan in accordance to the things that God is speaking to you about as you're praying. It gives you insight to the things that are happening around you, so you know how to plan in accordance to the times and the seasons that we are living in. You know what I mean? It's in prayer that God really begins to highlight things and make things clear to us. Now, whatever it is you are endeavoring to do in life, you're going to need the foresight to plan for it. Whether it's an education, whether it's maybe you're here and you're thinking about starting a business or starting your own company, or a certain career direction that you want to go in, or you want to start a family, or you're feeling called to the ministry. It's going to take foresight for you to know how to plan accordingly, right? And so planning is such an important thing. And as Nehemiah had been in prayer for 4 months, as we established last Sunday, there is no doubt that the situation he had been confronted with started becoming clearer and clearer, you know, as he was seeking God, and he began to make plans. He began to prepare and put a plan together for what God had put on his heart to do. And so some of you, I believe God is speaking to you about certain things pertaining to maybe your personal life or your career or your family, but you haven't even started planning for that. Again, you need to do that. Walking in faith, you know, a lot of people think that walking in faith means that, okay, I'm just going to wing it and walk in faith. But that's not how walking faith, that is actually irresponsible. You know, part of walking in faith is having the responsibility to take ownership of what God is speaking to you about and to plan in accordance to those things that are happening as a result of what God is saying to you, right? But we need to plan. In verses 1 through 9 of chapter 2, which is where we're going to be today, we see Nehemiah as a master planner, as a master planner. And today, we're going to consider 6 things that he did. But before we do that, let me give you 3 quick reasons why we need to plan. 3 quick reasons why we need to plan. Number one, why plan? Well, because God plans. We plan because God plans. Jeremiah 29:11, as you guys all know, "For I know the plans," God says, "I have for you. I know the plans I have for you," says the Lord. "They are plans for good and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope." One of the things that provides me with comfort and security, when things don't turn out the way that I had anticipated, when things don't turn out the way I had hoped, is knowing that God has a plan. Let me tell you, a couple years ago when we opened up the church, we were excited, the building was going, boom, COVID hit. Let me tell you, man, it was one of those things like, okay, we got a place to gather now, but we can't gather. We have a place to meet now, but we can't meet. You know what I mean? How are we going to pay for this place? You know what I mean? How are we going to do everything that we need to do? But let me tell you, the thing that brought solace and comfort to my heart was God continued to remind me, I have a plan. God, like I said last Sunday, God is not up in heaven scratching his head. Oh my gosh, there's a pandemic. What am I going to do? What's going to happen to the church? God had a plan, has a plan, has a plan. And so one of the things that provides great comfort and security to me is knowing that, and it should provide a sense of peace to you when things are not turning out exactly the way you had anticipated, because you need to understand that you're a child of God, and because you're his child, what does he say? He says, for I know the plans I have for you. I know the plans that I have for you. And the plans I have for you is to give you a future and a hope. I mean, isn't that awesome? No matter what's going on in your life, you have the promise of God that God has a plan for your life, and it's for good. It's for good. Now, things may not unfold, unravel, turn out exactly the way you want or have the same timing that you want things to happen, but God has a plan, and his plan is good. Do you know that even before the world had been created, the Bible says God had a plan of salvation? You know, as he was contemplating creating you and creating me and creating the universe and creating the world of people, and knowing beforehand, because God is omniscient, he knows everything, that we would sin and all of these things, God already had a plan in place for our salvation. He already had a plan. Listen to this. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 4 and 11 says, for he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. Verses 11, in him we were also chosen, having been predestined, notice, according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will. God already had a plan. He already planned for our salvation. You are not sitting here, if you are a child of God and you've made a decision to walk and serve Christ, you are not sitting here by coincidence. It is not by chance or happenstance that you're here, but it's because before the foundation of the world, God knew your name. God knew who you were, and he knew that one day you would be a son or daughter of God. God had a plan. He says, we were chosen in him before the creation of the world. I mean, man, that's powerful. I don't have time to unpack that too much today, but that is mind-blowing. I mean, we can talk for hours just about that. I mean, that's some heavy stuff. And so, why do we plan? Because God plans. Number two, we plan because God commands it. God commands it. When we were just kind of just, you know, skating through life, that's irresponsible. God expects us to be responsible enough to have a plan. And God commands it. Listen to this. 1 Corinthians 14, 33 says this, for God is not a God of disorder, but of peace. Verses 40 says, everything should be done in a fitting and orderly way. How many of you know, being able to do things in an orderly fashion requires what? It requires a plan. It requires a plan. Whenever things aren't planned well, things get, you know, just weird. Things get funky. Things get disorderly and chaotic really quick when there's not a plan. Seeing how God is a God of order because he always has a plan, it only stands to reason that we too should have a plan. We too should have a plan. Proverbs 4:26 says this, plan carefully what you do, and whatever you do will turn out right. See that? We need to have a plan. We need to have a plan. It's so important. You know, if you're married and you're in a relationship, you need to have a plan for that relationship. You need to know, like, hey, how we continue to develop in our relationship? How are we going to continue to grow? You need to have a plan. You can't just put it on cruise control and expect things to just go. Relationships need maintenance, and that requires a plan. Relationships need guidance and direction. Now, granted, there are some of you that are very low maintenance, and that's great when you're those kind of people where, you know, your marriage is good and the maintenance is not very high. But there is no such thing as no maintenance. There is no such thing. Every relationship requires maintenance. Every relationship needs a tune-up. Every relationship needs to be tweaked. You know what I mean? As a matter of fact, Kathy and I, we make it a point, you know, every year to have these heavy conversations to talk about where we are, where we feel we're going, where we want to be in the next 5 years. You know what I mean? And so it's important that we have a plan, because if you're just cruising through life on cruise control thinking that, okay, well, hopefully we just end up, no, it doesn't work that way. You need to have a plan. You need to have a plan, right? And so, again, plan carefully what you do, and whatever you do will turn out right. That's what it says. Thirdly, we plan because it's good stewardship. It's good stewardship. Ephesians 5:15 through 17 says this: be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Time management involves making the best use of the opportunities that we are presented with, and to do that requires planning. How many of you are managers or, owners of, how many of you lead people? There's a lot of you. There's a lot of you. And what I'm talking about, you know very well. Time management involves making the best use of the opportunities that we are presented with. And to do that, you've got to understand the importance of having a plan. It's good stewardship to plan. A poor steward, on the other hand, goes through life without any forethought, without any consideration, without any planning. Can you imagine for a moment what your life would look like if you never planned? Think about what your life would look like. I mean, if you just said, hey, you know what? Que sera, sera, we'll see what we see, what will be, will be. I mean, how do you think your life will? I mean, who do you think you would be with right now if there wasn't a plan? I mean, think about that. You might be with somebody like, believe me, I've talked to people and they tell me, I don't know how we ended up together. I have no idea. Well, because you guys were drunk out of your head, maybe at a bar, and, you know, that's how you hooked up, and that's what it was. You know what I mean? But I don't know. We don't have nothing in common. You know, and that's sad, but when there's not a plan, that's what happens. You wake up in the morning and you're like, oh, we're married. You know what I mean? It's like, okay. I mean, imagine, again, what your life would look like if you never planned anything. What you might be doing for a living. Where you'd be living. What the quality of your life would be like. You know, again, because you were just going with the flow and didn't have a plan. And let me tell you, that is not a good place to be. It's a scary thought to imagine what our lives could be like if we didn't plan. Okay? And so this is why we plan. This is why we plan. We plan because God plans. We plan because God commands it. And we plan because it's good stewardship. Now that we know the why of planning, we need to know the how of planning. We need to know the how of planning. You know, how leaders plan. And this is where we're going to zoom in Nehemiah's life and on our portion of scripture and our passage this morning. But I want to look at six things on how leaders plan. And number one, leaders take the time to think things through. If you're a leader, you're a thinker. If you're a leader, you're a thinker. In verses 1 of chapter 2 of Nehemiah, it says, early the following spring in the month of Nisan, not the car dealership, it was just the Persian month. This was 4 months later from when Nehemiah started praying, but he's waiting on God to open the doors for him to go to his homeland, Jerusalem, and begin the process of rebuilding. Undoubtedly, the longest 4 months of his life as he's just waiting on God. You know, how many of you know that when you're in a waiting period and you're waiting on God to answer, it's easy to become anxious. It's easy to become discouraged where you feel, how long is it going to take? God, when are you going to intervene? When are you going to answer my prayers? I'm sure that we've all found ourselves in this place of waiting one time or another, whether it's for a relationship. There's some of you are maybe waiting for this guy. Get your stuff together, dude, so we can get moving with our lives. You know what I mean? You're waiting, or you are waiting for her. I don't know. It could be a relationship. It could be a job opportunity that you're waiting for, that you've been banking on, but just waiting and waiting, and it still hasn't opened up yet. It could be a certain situation to change that you've been asking God. Change these circumstances. You know, let me tell you, this time of waiting could be very, you know, challenging, but believe me, it's in this time of waiting God is working. You hear what I'm saying? A lot of times we don't realize it's in this time of waiting God is working. He's working on your heart. He's working on your thought process. He's working on your attitude. How many of you know that your attitude affects your outlook? It affects your perspective. As you're waiting, God is working. He's doing things inside of you that you don't even recognize that need to get fixed. And so he's doing a work in your life as you're waiting. As you're waiting, God is working. And as Nehemiah was waiting, even though he had probably become anxious and discouraged, God was working. Working in him and also working in the king's heart, as we're going to see in just a minute. And so the season of opportunity finally arrives for Nehemiah to speak to the king about all that was on his heart, all that had been burdened upon his heart, all that God put into his heart. It finally arrives. And before I get into that, which I will in a moment, I want to ask the question that I want to consider with you is, what had been happening between the time that Nehemiah first began praying, which was 4 months ago, to the point that he was in? What had Nehemiah been doing all this time? He wasn't only praying, but as I said, he was thinking and he was planning. Leaders are thinkers. The wheels were going and he was working things out. You know, the theologian Howard Hendricks said this: nothing is more profitable than serious thinking, and nothing is more demanding. One of the problems that we have today in the world, in relationships, in government, wherever, is that we don't want to exercise the muscle, the mental muscle that it requires to think things through, to think about a solution. I mean, today we have a border crisis. We have thousands and thousands of people crossing the border illegally. And I'm wondering, is anybody thinking about a plan to fix this? I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on right now. Our gas prices are skyrocketing. Is anybody thinking about stuff? I mean, come on. Again, a lot of times we don't want to exercise the mental muscle that it requires to fix a situation. And so good leaders are thinkers. They are willing to sit down and take the time to think about things. Leaders need to have time, that time to think, time to get away, time to process. And so if you're a leader, it's imperative that you make time to think about things. It's imperative that you think about things. Proverbs 13:16 says this: a wise man thinks ahead, a fool doesn't, and even brags about it. Yeah, you know what? I'm just going to wing it, and whatever happens, happens. This is a foolish person's mentality, the Bible says. Proverbs 14:8 says this: the wise man looks ahead, the fool attempts to fool himself and won't face the facts. Wow. What's the point I'm making? It's wise to spend time thinking about your life and where you're headed. Three questions you need to ask yourself. Three questions. Number one, where am I now? In order for you to know where you're going, you need to know where you are. How many of you know what I'm talking about? You need to know exactly where you are, whether it is relationally, financially, in your education, wherever you are. Where am I now? Where am I? Right? In order for you to know what's happening in your life, where am I now? Second question, where do I want to be financially, relationally, educationally, whatever? Where do I want to be? Third question, how will I get there? How will I get there? That is such an important question because it's one thing to have vision, but it's another thing to know how to get there. How am I going to get there? How is this going to happen? That requires thinking. That requires planning. That requires processing. That requires exercising the mental muscle that it will take for you to figure out a plan to get you to where you need to be. And that's what Nehemiah did. He was thinking it through. He was praying and planning for 4 months. This wasn't something that he just jumped into. As a matter of fact, as we move on into the chapter, which I'm not going to cover today, it specifically says that Nehemiah didn't tell a soul about what he was processing, what he was thinking and praying about. He kept it to himself because he wanted to be crystal clear and he didn't want anybody to muck it up. He wanted to make sure that he was hearing from God, right? And so it's important that we are thinking through things. And what happens in this time of praying and planning is God, as I said, gives you vision and insight and foresight. I mean, that's the mark of good leadership. They know where they're going because they've received vision and direction from God. Again, if you're a leader, you need to be a person of vision. You need to be a person of vision. Proverbs 29:18, where there is no vision, the people perish. Where there is no vision, the people perish. A law of leadership is failing to plan is planning to fail. You guys hear what I'm saying? Failing to plan is planning to fail. And so it's important that we think things through. Number two, leaders not only are thinkers, but leaders plan. The way they plan is they prepare for opportunities. This is really important. They prepare for opportunities. When opportunity knocks, you need to be ready to open the door. You need to be ready. Life is full of opportunities. The question isn't, will I ever get any opportunities? That's not the question. The question is, will I be prepared for the opportunities that come my way? And here's the thing. If you are faithful with some of the smaller opportunities, trust me, bigger doors of opportunity will open for you. But if you can't be faithful in the little things, in the little opportunities that God presents you with, trust me, you will not be able to be ready for the bigger opportunities that come your way. So the question is never, will I get the opportunity? The question is, am I prepared? Am I prepared for the opportunities that are going to come my way? There are opportunities all around us, but a lot of times, we're just not ready for them. We're just not ready for them. In verses 1 and 2, it says this, in the month of Nisan, the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, the wine was brought to him, and I took the wine and I gave it to the king, and I had not been sad in his presence before. And so the king asked me, why does your face look so sad when you are not ill? This can be nothing but sadness of heart. And I was very much afraid. This is the moment that Nehemiah had been waiting for. He's been praying for an opportunity to have an audience with the king and to actually have a talk with him. Now it's come 4 months later. 4 months later. But when the king sees Nehemiah, the first question the king says is, hey, what's up, man? You look like you're bummed out. You look sad. And apparently, you know, Nehemiah was one of those people who couldn't fake it until you make it. You know what I mean? How many of you know there are people like that? Just fake it until you can make it. He couldn't roll that way. It just he couldn't hide the burden that he was carrying on his heart, on his face. It showed. But he says, I was very much afraid. Because the king saw that. You know why he was afraid? Because you couldn't be sad in front of a king. If you were a bummer in front of him, you could have your head chopped off. Because you know what? The king didn't want anyone around him who was going to rain on his party. He's going to rain on his parade. And so here you are. He's like, hey, man, you're messing up my juju, dude. You're messing up the vibe here. You need to get out of here. Because, you know what I mean? Because I don't need that kind of energy around me. And so he could have got killed for that. So this is why he says, I was very much afraid, because his life was in the balance at this moment, right? He was freaked out. But in spite of that, you know what? In spite of him being afraid, Nehemiah still presses on. You know, before I continue on, let me give you another leadership principle, and it's this. Leaders move ahead in spite of their fears. Leaders move ahead in spite of their fears. There is a myth that leaders are never afraid. Let me tell you, that's so false. That's not true. I can tell you firsthand, that's not true. I've had to confront the fears that I've felt inside on more occasions than I can count. You know what I mean? We have them. I think it's natural. I think it's normal at times. But the issue, again, isn't feeling the emotion of fear. The issue is not allowing fear that you're feeling to paralyze you and to keep you from doing what you know you need to do, what you know you need to say. You know, John Mayer has a song, and I love this song, but he says, say what you need to say. How many of you heard that song? I love that song. And the song is about being able to, you know, say the important things while you have the opportunity, being able to do the things that you need to do while the time affords you. Because how many of you know that none of us have an endless amount of time? We have seasons of opportunity. And let me ask you, do seasons pass? Yes, they do. Seasons of opportunity pass. They pass. And so you need to know how to seize them and not allow fear to paralyze you and keep you from entering into these seasons of opportunity that God has for you. See, courage is not the absence of feeling fear. Courage is the ability to face your fears and move beyond them in spite of how it feels. That's what courage is. Courage is not, hey, I don't feel that. Let me tell you, every Sunday I stand here and I get the jitters. I've been teaching for over 20 years, more than almost 30 years. And I still get the butterflies. I still, you know what I mean? I still get a little nervous standing in front of people. But you know what? I can't let that paralyze me and keep me from doing what God has called me to do. I wonder this morning what fear might be preventing you from doing what you need to do. What are some of the fears that are holding you back? Whatever it is, let me tell you, don't allow fear to paralyze you from doing what you know you need to do, from doing the right thing. Otherwise, let me tell you, you can miss out on the things that God has in store for you, the good things, the blessings, you know, the promotion. You never know, you know what I mean? But you cannot allow your fear to paralyze you. In spite of the fear Nehemiah feels, it says that he was terrified. He was shaking in his boots because the king took note of him. But let me tell you, it didn't keep him. It doesn't stop him from doing what he had to do and saying what he needed to say. Courage moves ahead in spite of the fear you may be feeling. And so Nehemiah, he presses forward. Verses 3 says, may the king live forever. I mean, man, just the wisdom of this guy. You know, he says, you know what? May the rule of Persia continue, man. Let it just continue to rock. He says, may your throne. He says, you know, let me assure you. He assures the king of his loyalty to him. And he says, may the king live forever. You know, may his rule and his kingdom continue to go forward. But then, as terrified as he was, he proceeds to express his heart. And he says, why should my face not look sad? The city where my fathers are buried lies in ruins, and its gates have been destroyed by fire. As scared as Nehemiah was, and he felt, he courageously tells the king the truth. He tells him the truth, what was in his heart, and what he had been burdened with. Verses 4 says, the king responds, what is it you want? I mean, that's heavy. What is it you want? In other words, what can I do for you? And this is powerful. You know what Nehemiah's instinct is? Let me ask you, what would your instinct be if the king came to you? What do you want? You know what it says? It says, then I prayed to the God of heaven. This is not talking about the 4 months of prayer he had been praying. Immediately, before he opened his mouth, and some of us need to take note here, before you open your mouth and fall into a ditch, you know what the rule of ditches are? How many of you know what the rule of ditches are? When you're in a ditch, stop digging. And some of you need to remember that in your marriage. When you're in a ditch, And your spouse, stop digging yourself, because before long you're like, oh man, I'm in deep. I should have just stopped, right? But you've dug yourself into a deep ditch. What does he do? What was his instinct? He says, you know what? He just shoots up a quick prayer. God, I need courage. I need wisdom. Help me to know what to say right now. And God answered that prayer. He answered that prayer. God was faithful. I mean, imagine the courage that it must have took for him to say what he said. Not only that, let me give you a piece of insight here. The courage it took Nehemiah, I mean, he made the same request. He made the same request to the same king to build the same walls that 13 years prior was rejected by the same king, King Artaxerxes, according to Ezra chapter 4. They asked the king this same thing that he's getting ready to ask him 13 years ago, to which the king said, no way. This ain't happening. This ain't happening. So, man, imagine the courage. I mean, if it was just men, I would use different terminology. Imagine the, I'll leave it right there. You know what I mean? This guy had some big shoes. He had some big shoes, man. We can never underestimate the power of the earnest prayers of a righteous person, even if they're short. Let me tell you, prayers don't have to be long to be powerful. Prayers don't have to be long to be effective. Sometimes it's that quick prayer, God, I need you. I can't do this without you. Boom, God just shows up. Let me tell you, I got a phone call. Oh, not a phone call. We got a text from Frank about a situation with his son. And I kid you not, within the hour, I don't even think it was an hour, but all of the pastors got the text. And all of our responses were on it, man. And I'm not kidding, man. I got on my knees. I'm like, Lord, I'm praying for my brother. I'm praying for the situation. And within the hour, we get a text, God opened the door. And I was just like, man, Lord, that was fast. That was fast. I was just like, man, God, you're awesome. So you can never underestimate the power of prayer, even if they're those quick prayers. Now, I'm going to be honest. I wasn't on my knees for like 45 minutes. I'm sorry, guys. But I did pray. And the prayer was sincere and earnest. You know what I mean? And man, I saw that text and it just put a smile on my face. I was like, God, you're so good. You're so good. That's the God that we serve. So we can never underestimate what God can do. And so here he's terrified, but yet he proceeds forward. So don't let your fear paralyze you and keep you from doing or saying what you need to do or say. Because a lot of you are afraid to do things, you're afraid to say things, and as a result of that, you're still in the same place because you've allowed fear to grip your heart. You've allowed fear to grip your heart. Number three, the third way leaders plan is they establish a goal. How many of you have goals in life? How many have goals in life? That's good. One person. Awesome. How many have goals in life? Verses 5 says, I answered the king, if it pleases the king and your servant has found favor in his sight, number one, let him send me to the city in Judah where my fathers are buried, and number two, so I can rebuild it. That was the plan. That was the plan. That was the goal, to rebuild it. Nehemiah gets very specific here. First, he seeks permission for a leave of absence to go to his homeland. And second, he seeks permission to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. I mean, goal setting is the next step in planning. It's the next step in planning. You know, you have to have a target. You have to have a target. As you've heard it said, if you aim at nothing, what will you hit? Nothing. You hit it all the time. If you aim at nothing, you're going to hit it all the time. You know, ask yourself again three questions. What do I want to be? What do I want to do? What do I want to have? Right? Those are the questions you have to ask yourself if you're going to establish a goal. You know, Pastor Rick Warren says something that I've kept in the back of my head for a long time. And this is something that we talk about as leaders and something that even as we speak, we recognize that we have to do. But he says there are two common errors that we make in goal setting. We set them too low, and we try to accomplish them too quickly. He says, set big goals, make big plans, so big, that God has to bail you out. I thought, that's awesome. That's awesome. You know why? Because if you could bail yourself out, then why do you need God? Right? So set goals that are so big that unless God shows up, it ain't happening. And let me tell you, we've done that. We've done that in this place. This place may not be a big deal to you. It's a big deal to us because we just didn't have it, don't have it. We're still walking in faith as we speak. We're still walking in faith. We're still believing God, and we're still setting big goals. We're still setting big goals about different things. It's crazy. But big planning is what you're expecting God to do. Not what you can do, but what God can do. Nehemiah said, I want to go and rebuild the walls around the whole city. That was a big goal. And keep in mind, what was Nehemiah's occupation? Anybody? He was a cupbearer. He wasn't a carpenter. He was a cupbearer. And so he goes, hey, I'm going to go out there and rebuild the walls. Dude, he didn't have the first sense of building anything. He wasn't a builder. He's never built anything, right? He's not a contractor. Yet he had a big goal. Why? Because he believed in a big and great and awesome God. Let me ask you, how big is your God? Because let your God determine the size of your goal. How big is your God? Your goals will speak to that. That's your goals will be telling about how big you believe God is, how great you believe God is, because again, your goals determine the size of your God. And if you believe that God is awesome, if you believe that God is almighty, then you should set goals that God need to fulfill. And don't you know, tell God, okay, you got to do this in the times in a month span. You know what I mean? Let God do it. Just say, God, you know what? I believe this is, you know, you're going to do it. You're going to do it in your time, right? And so we set our goals too low and we try to accomplish them too quickly. But we need to understand that God has a timetable and God is great. And so we should never underestimate what God can do. The fourth way leaders plan is by setting a deadline. How many of you have a deadline on certain things? How many of you know that deadlines are needed? How many of you work for somebody right now? Do they give you a deadline? Absolutely. I know that Mr. Tesla back there knows what I'm talking about, right? People will often say, that guy has all the luck. He always gets all the breaks. But you know, the truth of the matter is I found that the more I pray, the more I plan, the luckier I appear to be. But the truth be told is there are plenty of opportunities. You just have to be ready for them. Right. And you have to learn how to establish the right goals and set a deadline. Set a deadline. Verses 6, listen to what he says. Then the king with the queen sitting beside him asked me, how long will your journey take? And when will you get back? And I said, it pleased the king to send me. Look what it says. So I set a time. In other words, Nehemiah established a deadline. A goal must have a deadline. If your goal doesn't have a deadline, it's not a goal. This is the scheduling part of planning, knowing what you want to do and when you want to do it. And Nehemiah establishes a deadline. There's certain things that require a deadline. If you're a parent, you know that, right? You know that. If you ask your child to do something and it doesn't get done within a certain time, what happens? Well, they're grounded. They're in trouble, right? Because things need to get done. You tell them to take out the trash, but it doesn't go out for a week. What happens? You're like, hey, man, what's going on? The house stinks. What's going on here? Right? You need to establish a deadline. Nehemiah does that. Fifth way leaders plan is anticipate problems that could arise. Verses 7 says this, and this is so indicative of a leader who makes plans. It says, if it pleases the king, now he's getting a little bold. May I have letters to the governor of Trans-Euphrates so that they will provide me safe conduct until I arrive in Judah. You know, this was a trip that would take, it was about 800 to 1,000 miles from Iraq to Jerusalem. And Nehemiah had to go through a lot of provinces, right? In those days, you didn't travel freely. You had to go through proper procedures and have traveling permits, and to travel freely, you couldn't do that without these things. And so having carefully considered all of this, Nehemiah asked the king for letters of authority so he could have smooth sailing and no problems on his journey. What does this imply? This implies, again, that Nehemiah gave careful thought to every step of his plan. Remember, he's just asked right on the spot, what do you want? What do you want? And because he had time to really think about it, he was able to answer with precision with the things that he needed. Again, this is a clear example of planning. He wasn't just praying during those 4 months, you know, but he was also planning. So when the opportunity arose, he could clearly ask for the things that he needed. In planning a project, it's important to ask yourself questions like, what could keep me or hold me back? Okay. What could go wrong? What do I need to accomplish this task? Nehemiah gave careful thought about all of these things as he prayed and he planned. Now, before I move to another, the last point here, let me give you another leadership principle, and that is the importance in being able to distinguish the difference between a manager and a leader. How many of you know the difference between a manager and a leader? Does anybody know the difference? Focus on solving today's problems, and they're needed, they're essential. But leaders focus on solving tomorrow's problems. That's the difference. And I know that there are business owners here, and they know exactly what I'm talking about. They know exactly what I'm talking about, because when you own a business, you're not just thinking about what's coming in today. You're thinking about, hey, what's down the road? What's going on? You're thinking about things that can happen. See? But again, I'm not minimizing any one of these things, because these managers and leaders are to organizations, family, businesses, they're both needed. They're both essential. But it's important that you recognize they're not the same. They're not the same. Managers focus on day-to-day details, today's issues. The task of leadership is to anticipate things that nobody else is even thinking about and figure out a way to overcome these issues before they even get here, right? A leader needs to think further in advance, right? And here's the thing. God has called us all to be leaders in different spheres and different places. But you know what? A leader is always a few steps ahead. He's always thinking ahead, and it's important that we do that. Proverbs 22:3 says this, a prudent person foresees danger and takes precautions, but the simpleton goes blindly on and suffers the consequences. How many of you know what a simpleton is? How many of you know what a simpleton is? A simpleton is one who lacks common sense. How many of you know that you can be highly educated, you can have vast amounts of knowledge, but be very, just lack common sense? I mean, I know people that are, I mean, the IQs are through the roof, but when it comes to common sense things, they just don't have it. But a simpleton is one who lacks common sense. I have to admit, there have been various times in my life that I guess I've been a simpleton, and I've failed to see the problems I was getting myself into. You know, one of the laws of life is that it's always easier to get in than it is to get out. How many of you know what I'm saying? If you know what I'm saying, say amen. It's always easier to get in than it is to get out. It's easier to get into debt than it is to get out of debt. You guys agree? Yes. It's easier to get into a relationship than to get out of one. If you're in a bad relationship, it's like, oh man, how do I get out? Right? It's easier to fill up your schedule than to eliminate things from your schedule. Right? That's one of the laws of life. It's easier to get in than to get out. Again, leaders think about these things. They look ahead. Proverbs 27:12 says, sensible people will see trouble coming and avoid it, but an unthinking person will walk right into it and regret it later. And you know what? I'm not going to stand up here and pretend that's never happened to me, because it has. There have been those times in my life that I lacked the sense, because here I was in a situation where I was like, man, oh, I can't believe I'm in this place. But you know what? It was because I didn't have any forethought or foresight. Being a leader is the ability to anticipate problems in advance and prepare and plan for them. You know, and this is what God is calling us to do. The last principle I want to give you that how leaders plan is they count the cost. They calculate the cost. This is the budgeting part of planning. Principle number 4 is the scheduling part of planning. This is the budgeting part. In planning, it takes both time and money. As you know, everything in life has a price tag. There is, right? There's a price tag. And here we have Nehemiah's third request, verses 8. And may I have a letter to Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest, so he will give me timber to make beams for the gates of the citadel by the temple and for the city wall and for the residence I will occupy. I mean, Nehemiah basically gives the king a shopping list. First, I want you to let me go. Second, I want you to give me letters that permit me to go. Third, I want you to provide all the resources I need. Code for means, I want you to pay for all of it. That's what he was saying. I want you to pay for it. He asked for lumber for three things. First, I want to build beams for the city gates. Second, I'm going to need lumber for the city walls. And third, I'm going to need lumber because I'm going to need a place to live in and I need a home to build for myself. Again, remember, Nehemiah's not a contractor. He's never built anything in his life. He's a cupbearer. Yet when the opportunity arose, he knew exactly what he needed. Why? Because he had planned. Because he had planned. He knew what to, he calculated the cost. You know, this whole chapter indicates that he had already knew what he was doing when he got into this situation. He already knew. He already knew because he had been spending time with God. He already had a sense of this, you know. And the point I want to make here is God has amazing opportunities for every single one of us. Amazing opportunities for all of you. But you need to be prepared to take advantage of them when they come. I don't know when they're going to come, but they will come. And when they come, you need to be ready. I mean, if Nehemiah had not given thought and planned anything, man, think about what that would have looked like. I mean, imagine Nehemiah's conversation when he left the city and he met the first official outside the city, you know, if he had not planned. As he's leaving, they would have asked him, where are you going? You know, he would have said, well, I'm going to Jerusalem. Okay, where are your letters? Where are your papers? What letters? What papers? What are you talking about? Sorry, I can't let you go through. You need to go back. And he would have to do it all over again because he didn't think it through. He didn't think it through. We need to prepare. An essential law of leadership is, you know, again, leaders prepare, they plan, they think things through, and they seize opportunities while they're in front of them. You know, we need to believe God and trust God. But as we're believing God and trusting God and walking faith, that doesn't mean that we are not practical. You know, you guys know that I'm a person of faith, but I'm also a realist. I'm not removed from the reality of things. And the reality of things means that walking in faith does not mean or give me the license to be irresponsible and just wing things. But you know what I mean? But we have to prepare. And you know, and so this morning, you know, I actually have to wrap it up, but I want to encourage you guys because I believe God is going to put you in places of influence for a specific purpose, for a specific reason, and you need to prepare yourself for whatever that might look like and whatever that might be. And so let me close here in verses 8 where it says this. In conclusion, Nehemiah says this, and I love this. He says, because the gracious hand of my God was upon me, the king granted my request. You see what Nehemiah does here? He does something really powerful. He's careful to give God the glory. He's careful to give God the credit. He doesn't say, because of my genius master skills, all of this happened. You know, God has put me in places in front of people where I'm just blown away. And all I can say is I echo what Nehemiah says. Because the gracious hand of my God was upon me, the king granted my request. You know, when you find favor before God, let me tell you, you can stand before kings. You can stand before people of prominence and power. Why? Because the gracious hand of God is upon your life and they recognize the anointing of God's presence on your life. And they too will say, I got you, man. I got you. And we all want that. But again, we need to be responsible with the things that God puts before us. Let's bow our heads as we pray today. Father, thank you, God, for Nehemiah's life and the example, Lord, that he gives us in his word, Lord. Lord, what an amazing leader. What an amazing example of, Lord God, just faith and practicality, Lord God. What a beautiful example of the harmony that takes place between your part, God, and our part in accomplishing things on earth. Lord God, we know that you're sovereign, and we pray, God, for your sovereignty, Lord, in your rule in things to set up circumstances that are outside of our control. But I pray that you give us the wisdom to plan for the things that you put under our control, and that we are good stewards, Lord, as we venture out in faith, believing you for the things that you desire to do in and through our lives. And so I pray for each person here, Lord God, that you'd continue to encourage them and strengthen them and give them insight and foresight as they're moving through this journey that we call life, Lord, and that they're preparing and planning for the things that are around the corner that could really make a difference in their lives, Lord. And so I pray, God, right now, Lord God, that you would just continue, Lord God, to open the eyes of our understanding, that you continue to give us insight and foresight. You give us wisdom and how to proceed. As every head is bowed and every eye is closed, you know, maybe today there's some of you, you know, who, man, you're being presented with the greatest opportunity, and that is simply, man, to enter into a relationship with Christ. Maybe you've never done that before, and God is here, and he's extending this opportunity to tell you that, hey, you know what? I want to be your God. I want to guide you. I want to love you. I want to lead you. I want you to know the path of life. But it begins by you, you know, recognizing this season of opportunity. You know, the Bible says no man is promised tomorrow. We make plans, but ultimately God knows how many days, how many minutes, how many hours we have left in this life. And there's a season of opportunity possibly for some of you in this place, or maybe some of you who are watching, and God is telling you, you know what? Invite me into your heart and into your life, because I want to guide you. I want to love you. I want to lead you. If that's you this morning, I want you to just say this prayer with me today. Lord Jesus, thank you for the counsel of your word today. And Lord, I recognize this season of opportunity, Lord God, and how no man is promised tomorrow. And today, Lord, I open my heart and my life, and I invite you to take residence in my soul, in my spirit, in my heart, and to be the Lord of my life. I confess you as Lord, and from this day forward, teach me to walk with you and to know you and to know the plans that you have for my life and the things that you desire to do in me and through me. I believe that you paid the price for my sins on the cross, Lord, and that you rose from the dead. And today, Lord God, I receive the gift of salvation. And it's in Jesus' name I pray this. Amen. Praise God. Why don't we all stand as we worship the Lord? Pastor Darren's going to come up as we prepare for communion as well.
Thank you, Pastor. What a great message, right? I mean, it's amazing. I mean, planning is such it seems like such a simple thing, but you know, when we plan and ask God to meet us there, when we're plan, like Pastor said, when we plan assuming that God's going to be there, that God's going to bail us out, it's amazing, because every time he will meet us there. Every time he will meet us there. And it's so amazing that we get to experience that as believers. And wow, what a great word. Amen. Well, again, we get to celebrate communion today, and Sundays are awesome. Every Sunday is great, but Communion Sundays are super special for us, and because we get to celebrate together. We get to remember what Jesus did on the cross, that Jesus defeated death and sin and the grave and the power that sin has over us, and he gave us heaven. He defeated the wrath of God. He inserted himself between the wrath of God and us, because we deserved it. We all deserve it. I deserve it. And he took our place. He took my place. And we get to celebrate too, because, you know, the Bible says when we take communion, when we receive communion, we're announcing the Lord's death until he comes again. So we get to celebrate that he's coming back. And Jesus is coming back, and he's going to fix all this and all the stuff that we were just talking about. He's going to fix it all. And he's going to take us to heaven to be with him. And we're going to be in heaven with him and with all the people we love forever. That's what we get to celebrate. We get to remember and celebrate that together today. So if you're here, we hopefully you picked up a communion cup. It looks like this on the way in. If you didn't grab one, our usher's going to walk around and bring some. So just let us know if you need one, and we'll get you one. And if you're joining us online, now's a great time. We'd love for you to join us as well. Just grab some cracker or some bread and some juice, and just join us as we do this together. Wherever you are, we wanna do this with you. So our worship team is gonna lead us in a song, and just as they do, let me just invite you to do that, to remember, to celebrate what Jesus did for you, and what he did for all of us. So let's worship.
The mountain I could not climb.
lead us in communion, I'm always blown away. But this moment right here is always, this is such a sacred moment. You know, we get to worship God, and we get to remember, as I said, and celebrate what he did for us. It is literally impossible for us to comprehend the love God has for us, the love that he sent his son to die for us, to take all the punishment we deserve, take everything that we earned by our sin and take it on himself. He gave up everything, literally, for people who don't deserve it, like me, people who don't deserve anything. Jesus willingly accepted it for every single one of my sins, every single one of your sins. He took it all just because he loves us. When I was young, maybe you all have heard this too, there was an acronym we learned for GRACE. It's God's riches at Christ's expense. That's what we get. We get God's riches. We get all of heaven's riches because of what Christ did. All that heaven has to offer is ours now because of what Jesus did. So let's just bow our heads and I'll pray us in. Dear Father, I just want to pray again for every one of us that you would remind us of the love that you have for us, not a condemning love, not a angry love, not a spiteful anything, Father. You did all of this for us. You did this, Lord Jesus, for us because you love us. You suffered and died for me and for every person in here. And so, Father, I pray for your hope on all of us. I pray for you to remove any condemnation, any guilt, any shame that we have. Remind us that our sins are gone, Father. They are all gone because of what you did, Lord Jesus. And I pray that you would overwhelm every single person here, every single person listening today. You would overwhelm us with your love for us. And that you'd overwhelm us with the mercy and the grace that you have for us, so that we know that we are empowered to move forward in your spirit, by your power, free from the chains of sin that so often pull us down. So, Father, just bless this time with your presence, and thank you for Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Everybody said, amen. Go ahead and prepare your cup. Put back a little film. I'm just going to read a little verse for us. 1 Corinthians 11:23 says, on the night he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread and spoke a prayer of thanksgiving. He broke the bread and said, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's eat the bread together. And now the juice. Again, let me read on in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 25. It says, when supper was over, he did the same with the cup. He said, this cup is the new promise made with my blood. Every time you drink of it, do it to remember me. Let's drink the juice together. Now will you pray with me? Father, thank you again for this wonderful time together. We gather with your people. We gather around your word. We gather and celebrate your presence and communion and the salvation that you procured for each one of us. Thank you, Father, and fill us with your Holy Spirit as we leave this place to enable us to witness to all of those around us, to serve all of those around us, to live lives that are worthy of the name Jesus, the name that you put on each one of us. Father, we pray for change. We pray for your Holy Spirit to overwhelm us and all around us. We pray for our world to change. We pray for the people to see your kingdom and move and join. And Father, we pray that you would use us for whatever part of that you want. And Father, I pray for freedom for each one of us from the sins that tear us down and shame us and guilt us and condemn us. I pray for freedom, Holy Spirit, that you would break the chains of all of us, that we would move out in faith, confident in your presence, and that you're already there, ready to meet with us. Thank you, Father, for the word and for the day-to-day, and just bless every one of us this week. We pray all this in Jesus' awesome name. Amen. Thank you all for joining us this morning. So good to see you all, as always. Really appreciate this Sunday, as always, with you. Get on our website. Check us out. Follow us. Thank you for your prayers and for your financial support. Obviously, we couldn't do any of this without you. We love you guys. We'll see you next week.